lump of numbers, and it doesn't make any sense to me. It's cool to see, you know, how things can change between two different shows. Here we go.
Wow, that's really cool.
Hey everyone, my name is Ethan, and for the past 7 years, I've been working in esports as a broadcast producer. Today, I want to take a look at some of the top clips this week and talk about them, maybe reveal some of the things going on behind the scenes that we have to deal with. Let's jump in. This first clip comes from ESL1, the Dota 2 Championship Grand Finals. Now, last week I watched the AR Dragon from League of Legends, and to me, this sort of emulates that. Let's take a peek and see what they do a little bit differently. Ooh, I always love a good countdown. Man, this is a great camera shot. The slow push into the stage. Wow. Real quick, before we continue, one note. Whenever you do a countdown leading up and you're getting the crowd hyped up, I'm never a big fan of then suddenly removing all of that hype for something kind of quieter. Like here, they're building up to something and then they kind of go back into some serene music playing a landscape. I feel like it's a bit of a lost moment to build up to something and then take it away so quickly, but I'm curious to see what they do next. All right, I got some fire. I didn't watch a lot of this tournament, but I imagine a big theme was fire, phoenix, rebirth maybe. Wow. Here we go. Wow, it's really cool. It's cool how they integrated the sparks with the AR Phoenix there. It's hard to, you know, combine the two. I think I've seen enough there. That is an awesome intro ceremony. And to be honest, it reminds me of a lot of the League of Legends AR Dragon that we looked at last week, because it's a winged creature flying around an arena, you know, making a lot of noise and then having a land and a cool, you know, moment for the crowd. They did a lot of new things that the League of Legends show did not. This is, you know, 4 years past now. Very much more integrated with the stage. There were sparks flying. There was a light show. They had a whole intro video showing off the Phoenix before, you know, it entered the arena, which is really cool. But I'm also more interested in AR these days into how they can help tell a broadcast story of the match. Like, these intro segments, you know, generate a lot of hype, get people watching and maybe tuning into the show. But what else can we use AR for? Can we use it to, I've seen a lot of times actually, like champion or hero select, they'll animate the hero in the arena when a character or when a player picks that character. That's really cool. That helps actually tell the story of what's going on in the match. So I want to see more things like that, where they're more integrated into what's going on between the two teams, rather than a cool hype piece. Because don't get me wrong, this is awesome. I love to see this, but I feel like there's more that can be done with AR. And yes, it's expensive. Yes, it's very new, but I'm sure that's a whole new frontier that we're about to jump into. So it's exciting. It's pretty cool. All of these clips today I found myself, but if you have some clips you want to recommend to me to watch, leave them in the comments below. I'll take a peek and watch it next time. So the next clip I want to break down is actually a series of clips. I kind of want to go from the beginning of Valorant esports to where we are now and look at how the in-game HUD has changed over time. Because when a new game comes out, a lot of teams are scrambling to figure out, all right, how do we best present information? And slowly but surely, you know, teams learn, graphics teams, producers learn new and better ways to present the information on screen. And I think the Valorant one is the most recent case of this happening and a very interesting one. So let's take a look. So this first clip is very early on for Valorant esports. It's the first strike qualifier. And right away, you can see kind of the things that they've added to the screen. So the player icons at the top, that's part of the game. But then the Envy Cloud 9 and the numbers there, that's been added by the broadcast team. And then, of course, the best of three grand finals on the right side there, that's added by the broadcast team. And then the lower left corner, that whole box is added as well. First things first, they have emulated the style of Valorant a little bit in the top. So they have all the triangles, the harsh edges and corners. They're trying to make sure that it kind of fits the style of the game, which is important. You want to make sure that things don't stick out too much as a viewer. I think there are some sizing issues here, which they update later on. A lot of the numbers in the middle are pretty small. A lot of esports viewers are watching on mobile. I'd say it's around 50 to 60%, depending on, you know, games, it can fluctuate. And those map scores, the numbers in the red boxes above Envy and Cloud9 Blue, those are probably too small for mobile viewers to look at. So I think if they want to give that information, they should probably expand it. Second thing is, I think the best of three grand finals bar on the right side is pretty large. That is important information. Best of three grand finals, you want to know how long a match is and also where you are in the tournament very quickly. But that's probably too big right in the middle of kind of where you want viewers to be able to see. I think people would probably say that's blocking some of their view because it's just kind of in the middle. And the bar on the left side, bottom left side, those sponsor bars are usually not opaque like that. Usually they're transparent and maybe divvied up around the screen a bit more rather than taking up such a large spot. I imagine during this time of Valorant, there was a pretty empty spot down there. So they just, you know, plop that in. But to me, it is very opaque. It's taking a lot of screen real estate. One of the most challenging things and one of the most important things we talk about is what information actually needs to be on the screen. Because you could have a lot on the screen if you wanted to. And frankly, if you watch sports, they don't have a lot. They have exactly what's essential. The rest, you know, might be for hardcore viewers where you can hopefully find that information somewhere else. But you don't want to put everything on the screen because then it'll just get inundated with information. So it's a lot of, you know, what do we need? What's essential for the screen and how big does it need to be? Here, they have everything probably that you need, but I think the sizing is a bit wrong. You know, the team names are a bit small, the scores, the series scores are a bit small. Also, there's a lot of numbers close together. Look at the in-game score 1-3. That's next to 12-2, 12-3. Already you got three numbers next to each other, and then you have the 0-0. So if you're a new viewer tuning in, you're like, I don't know what all these numbers mean. There's just a clump of numbers, and it doesn't make any sense to me. I think you'll find a lot of esports now, we're moving away from showing so many numbers close together. In fact, we're starting to write series scores in prose and in words. Envy leads 1-0. That way it's crystal clear. You don't have to look at a number and know what it means. So this is another tournament going on in Valorant early on in its career, probably around the same time frame as First Strike. And this is a different production company doing this HUD. And look how different it is. They have the team names above the player names, which is probably smart. There's some empty space there. And they don't have much else. It's pretty clean, just what's essential. So I think it's interesting to see that there's different ways to do these things. They, again, are reusing the sharp edges. The colors are very different than what Valorant's doing. They wanted to say, hey, this is our HUD. We're bright orange, and I want you to know that this is what we're adding to the screen. It's cool to see, you know, how things can change between two different shows. So now we're watching Valorant Champs in Berlin. This is the end of 2021, and this is kind of the modern Valorant HUD. This is what you can expect to see if you tune in. One of the biggest changes comes from in-game, actually. They've moved the player icons from the top down to the sides, and you have a lot more information. You have their health, their shield, what gun they're using, their abilities, how much is left in their ultimate, all those fun stuff, which, you know, a esports viewer wants to see. And it honestly emulates a lot of Counter-Strike. I think Counter-Strike was a big source of inspiration for this change. Then we move to the top. We have logos for the teams, but they've shortened shorten the team names. They've used tricodes. They don't want to have a full, you know, long bar of team names, which I think is really smart. It saves real estate. And look how big the numbers are. Boom, 7, 12, you know exactly what's going on. And like I said before, they reduce the amount of numbers on the screen. So instead of showing the series score as 1-0, they have it as a little bullet filled in. So now the series is tied 1-1, and one side has a filled-in diamond, and the other has a filled-in diamond, which I think is a much better way to tell every viewer, hey, this is a series score. I think we're starting to learn, educate viewers that series score are the filled-in boxes, not necessarily the number on the screen. So yeah, I think this is a great evolution of the HUD, and I'm about to show you what we currently have, and it's very similar to this. So this is from the Valorant Champions Tour. And again, it's very similar to what we saw before. They did make a change to the player boxes on the sides. They moved the guns inside of the box now. They moved around where the information lays. I think it's probably better if you're a Valorant player to understand what's going on. The top, they've moved where the icons and the team names are. But in general, it's very similar. The biggest upgrade here is on the top left. They've added little boxes showing the map score from previous map and what's coming up, the map that's coming up. So you can see, you know, NRG just lost out on Bind 13-11, and currently they're on Haven, and next up is Split. So very cool addition to help tell the story, taking up very little space. And if you're a mobile viewer, you can see exactly what's going on. It's not hard at all to see the round scores here. Great stuff from Valorant. Very interesting to see the evolution over time and how things have been upgraded and helped the viewer understand what's going on. I've kind of simplified some of the talking points and things that we discuss when we talk about an in-game HUD when we're developing one. But in general, those are the big things that we talk about. Is it mobile friendly? Do we have the information we need on the screen? And is it easily presentable? Does it make sense to the viewer very quickly what's going on? Thanks for watching. If you like this video, please subscribe, because I'm a new channel trying to get some subscribers. And if you have some clips to show me, leave them in the comments below. I'll take a peek. Thank you.